Digging deeper tonight, new concerns about an alleged epidemic of sex abuse being covered up in New York's ultra-Orthodox Hasidic Jewish community. It's a sect where ancient traditions collide with the modern world. It's also a powerful voting bloc for Brooklyn politicians. That includes a veteran district attorney who some say is willing to sacrifice justice for the young victims to win the support of powerful rabbis. Gary Tuchman investigates.
The ultra-Orthodox are a small percentage of Jews as a whole. But Brooklyn, New York, with tens of thousands of ultra-Orthodox Jews, is the largest such population outside of Israel. One of them is Rabbi Nochum Rosenberg.
So your Judaism is as strong as ever?
Yes, it is.
But Rabbi Rosenberg is troubled.
You're saying that you believe that one out of five children in your community has been molested?
Yes. We believe that. We know that.
Allegations of a widespread sex abuse cover-up in this community have led Rabbi Rosenberg to launch a hotline for victims and their families. But if you think everyone would be thanking him for his efforts, you'd be wrong. He's not subjected to things like this. Posters plastered around the community with his face on a snake, with the words corrupt traitor spelled out in Hebrew. Also.
So you say you've received death threats because of this?
Death threats on a daily basis.
The ultra-Orthodox Jewish world is very insular. In many ways, life is lived like it was many centuries ago. Back then, there was deep distrust of the outside world, and that's the case today. Problem with cutting yourself off from people like police is that child molesters and other scoundrels often take advantage.
Because of the distrust of outsiders, people in this community generally report alleged crimes to religious authorities, not to police, and will almost never talk to a stranger on camera.
Sir, can I ask you a quick question? I'm with CNN. We're doing a story about the community. If there's a crime, I'm at CNN, we're doing a story about the community.
And when they do talk, you're likely to hear something like this.
Do you think child molestations happen in this neighborhood?
No.
Not at all?
Not at all.
So when you hear about things like that happening, you don't think they're true?
That's not true.
You think people are making it up?
Yes. In this neighborhood, cannot happen.
Why do you think that?
It never happened.
The secular world.
Don't tell that to Pearl Engelman, a faithful member of the community, who says her son Joel, one of her seven children, was molested by a school official starting when he was 8 years old.
It pains me. It pains me terribly.
She and her husband never knew about it while it was going on. She told leaders in the community when she found out, but for the most part, she says it was kept quiet. And almost 20 years later, it's too late to go to police. The statute of limitations has expired.
The cover-up is what devastates me, because we are not the kind of people to cover this up. We stand for the truth. We stand for justice.
Her son, now 27, has left the community. So is this man, Luzer Tworsky, who says he was molested for years by a tutor.
And you were how old?
I was 9.
And he was how old?
Probably in his late 20s, or something like mid-20s.
And that's the man who molested you?
Yes.
One would presume that Brooklyn's district attorney and his chief of sex crimes would be all over these allegations. And indeed, they say they are.
Any time we have a single case, it's very serious to us.
They know exactly what I'm doing when I'm prosecuting people from their community. They know the people who we send to jail.
But disturbingly, the people you've met in this story, as well as others, believe 22-year veteran D.A. Charles Hines is part of the problem. They say this Catholic D.A. protects suspected ultra-Orthodox Jewish molesters so he can stay in office.
Well, this is a block vote. This is when the rabbis say vote for Charles Hines, there will be nobody here that will not vote for Charles Hines.
He cares about his election. He cares about staying in as district attorney. He doesn't care about the victims.
There is anger that Charles Hines does not release names of suspected molesters in the ultra-Orthodox community. Releasing suspects' names is standard procedure at prosecutors' offices all over the United States.
Your position is that you don't release the names of accused Orthodox Jewish suspects.
Correct.
And why is that?
Because in releasing the names, within days, magically, they find the name of the victim and then the intimidation starts.
But do you do that with any other community?
No. I mean, if the Amish people were living here, I suppose I'd have the same practice.
But not the Roman Catholic Church.
No, there's never been any allegations about intimidation by priests.
But don't you see that some could see that means you're trying to curry favor with a very important black voting group for you?
And my answer is, again, I show an odd way of showing my gratitude with all of the cases I have brought.
The DA says over the last 3 years, he's been able to substantially increase arrests after starting a special program to reach out to victims and convince them to talk to outside authorities. Pearl Engelman doesn't believe much of what the DA says, but notably admits she too did not tell the police when she found out her son had been molested.
It didn't even enter my mind.
How come?
We don't go to the police. We take care of things in the community itself.
Taking care of the community at the expense, it seems, of the victims.
It's an incredible statistic. One in five, potentially, kids have been abused in that community, if that's true. I mean, that's unbelievable. Has there been an increase in arrests since the DA started withholding names?
Yeah, well, the DA has been in office more than two decades, 22 years, and he admits for the first 19 of those years, there were very few arrests. And he says over the last three, they've had 101 arrests. Now, is that a big number? I don't know. I don't know how many more people are out there. And is that because he's holding the names? Don't know the answer to that either. But I do know that the DA has just made a decision that he will release the names of people arrested if the victims in his or her family wants the names to be released. But it's a tough onus to put on victims to make that kind of decision, right, yeah, in that community where it's so insular.
Right. It's fascinating. Gary Tuchman, appreciate it. We'll continue to follow it.